God has given us this next, and closing out this series is going to be tough just because there's so much more to learn from the book of Romans, especially as it relates to our subject matter for this past several months, and that is living a purpose-driven life. Paul is just taking us to higher heights as he begins to challenge the church to do better. And we know the old cliche that we live by, if you do better, if you know better, you do better. And I think I said that directly. You do better, you know better. Heretofore, there are a lot of us who just didn't know. And because we didn't know, there were some things we may have overlooked or omitted. But as we grow in faith and increase in knowledge, we have some days where we know we're willing to change our minds about some things. But in the grand sense of things, we need to understand that our seasons are individual. And every one of us is in a different season in our lives. There are very few times, if you study the Old Testament rather, that God gives a corporate season, a season that connects individual seasons into one. So a lot of times we don't present it that way because everybody is on this Christian journey, we're on this pilgrim journey. And I remember one preacher says, it used to be we were on traveling through together through this barren land, and now it seems like we're just on the same bus and just heading in the same direction, but we ain't traveling together. And so I can attest to that, that oftentimes we start to break away, and the church is notorious for trying to find a way to get away from other churches. We can't continue to function like that. It's not like our families where we look forward to growing up and getting away from home and starting our own life. Many of us, all of us, have experienced that at this point in life where we had to get away from home. And we try to spiritualize that, but we don't have to spiritualize it. It's a reality. God told Abraham to get away from his home and his father's house. But Abraham was 7 years old when he said that. So if I'm waiting to 70 to leave home, I'm in trouble. But it's hard to fathom that in this mindset, in this day and time. I can't fathom Christiana Hens being at home to the 7th, man. I'm going to leave, and so they can have it. And I'm going to go buy that motorhome. So you see my motorhome out front of the church and say, Pastor. But otherwise, I think I can live with it until the 7th. And so what we take from the Word is that God allows us to learn from. And there are a number of things that we will talk about tonight. I won't get to them all, but I want to at least put them in your spirit for your consideration. And the challenge tonight is to deepen our knowledge of the truths about living a life pleasing unto God. And the word living speaks volumes to the fact that we are not dead. And so as long as we're breathing, as long as we're living, we still have expectations and requirements associated with our lives as people of God. The devil does not require anything of you but that you remain faithful to his way. But the Lord requires excellence. And that requires us to make some changes in our judgment, in our decision making, in our circles, the way we handle business, the way we treat each other. There's a lot that must take place in order for us to reach the level of expectation that God has for us. And that's the hard part because it's easy to do wrong. It's easy to exclude people. It's easy to walk away from relationships. It's easy to get in my car and just pull off. It's easy. It's hard to stay there in spite of what's going on. It's hard to say, I will forgive you right now, and I'm not going to let this come between us. It's hard to say that. And we say that we want the patience of Job, but I don't want the patience of Job because then I have to go through what Job went through. Mm-hmm. And Job said, though he slay me yet, will I trust him? And that's after he lost everything and lost all his kids. But there's a New Testament parable of what happens when somebody loses their keys or loses their coin and loses one sheep. Somebody's got to go and find that sheep. She had to go and find that coin. And so there was a lot of work put into going to find that coin and that sheep. And I tell you today, there's a lot of work in maintaining a relationship with God. And when people leave, we're expected to go and find them. Mm-hmm. That's a lot of work. Amen. When people are broken, when people are empty, when people are despondent, it's our responsibility as a church to do something about it. Didn't know that I would be going through myself, amen, or having to deal with my own issues while I'm trying to help somebody else. But again, we're trying to learn to live beyond our capacity. Because in the body of Christ, we are blessed with the gifts of God. We're blessed with the power of God, the Spirit of God, the Son of God, presence of God, all of those at our disposal. So at the end of the day, guess what? We have no excuse. Now, granted, in the natural realm, we can make excuses because of how we feel. But when it comes to God, there is no, we can't base it on how we feel, because as Paul writes, when I'm weak, he's strong. When I'm sick, he makes me well. When I'm empty, he fills me up. So I don't have very much room, amen, to make any excuses about why I cannot do what God has called me to do. And so, as we unpack this just a little bit tonight, I do challenge you, amen, to write some things down, make a note. There are lessons available. I guess I didn't print them out, and so I apologize that I didn't print them out for you today. You don't have to run the copy. I'll get make sure we get copies. But I will be referencing that pretty much tonight, just so we can kind of walk through it, so we can hopefully give you some clarity about what the Lord is pouring in me. There are, in my opinion, four important characteristics that are required of every believer in order for us to live a life pleasing to God. They're basic. Things that we've heard and clearly should understand and work toward obtaining. They are obedience, faith, hope, and love. We need those in order to make it. In this life, for this work, we need obedience, faith, hope, and love. And there are several scriptures that we pulled out today that were instrumental in helping us to understand why it's important for us to have those four things. And 1 Samuel 15:22, Samuel requires and says God honors sacrifice. But he goes a step further, and the Bible says in 15:22 for Samuel that it's better to obey than to sacrifice. A lot of times, many of us make sacrifices, but it's totally against God's word. And so we can't substitute obedience for sacrifice. So God wants us to obey rather than sacrifice. He honors our sacrifice, but he responds to our obedience. Yeah. And he also responds to our disobedience. So Samuel had to expose that to Saul. Also, in Jeremiah 7:23, I want you to hear what the word of the Lord declares through the prophet Jeremiah as it relates to obedience. And Jeremiah 7:23 says these words, but this thing commanded I them, saying, obey my voice, and I will be your God, and ye shall be my people, and walk ye in all the ways that I have commanded you, that it may be well with you. So that there are some stipulations there. In order for life to be well with me, that means I am responsible for doing what? Obeying the commands of God. Mm-hmm. So I can't get away from God, nor can I make any excuses about why I can't do what God has asked me to do, because he's provided everything that I need. When you read 1 Corinthians 13:13, it's a very, very familiar passage of scripture that Paul writes to the church at Corinth. And it simply talks about the basis of those foundational things that we talked about. He says, now abide in these, faith, let me get this right here. Now abide in faith, hope, charity, these three, but the greatest of these is charity. I know charity is love. And when you look at Hebrews 11:6, the Bible says in Hebrews 11:6, along those same lines, these words, he says, writer writes this, but without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So you see the significance of obedience, of faith, hope, and love. We got to have all of those things as a part of our character in order for us to live a life that's pleasing to God. But those things cannot be acquired without having a relationship with God. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. And I talked to you last week about the totality of God, about embracing the totality of God, about being able to embrace God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. You can't exclude one from the other. We talk about the Godhead, and we talk about the Trinity, but when you think about God the Father and what it represents to be under the command to surrender to the lordship and kingship of God, because this is his realm, this is the heavenly realm. Think about Jesus and the Lordship over the church, and then you think about the Holy Spirit that lives in us. So you cannot escape the presence of God. So the totality of God is in those three persons. And so I got to embrace all of that. And I can't walk away from this experience thinking I'm just going to only have a connection with God. I got to have some type of connection to all three. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. So I challenge us tonight, as we open our hearts and our minds to receive, that we have an expectation of God to release the revelation necessary for us to grow from, but also that we know that God has an expectation of us. That when he releases the revelation, that we walk away better than we were before we came. Mm-hmm. And that's the hard part, but also that's the reward. So I have the privilege of gaining something just tonight. And if I gain something tonight and I gain something tomorrow, just imagine how much stronger I will be when the real enemy, the attacks come. Because the forces that I'm walking under are not of myself. Mm-hmm. They are the living God. And that is where the church has got to be confident. And that's why the Hebrew writer in this we should cast not away therefore our confidence, for it shall bring great repentance of reward. In other words, if God doesn't look like he's coming today, just hold tight, he's on his way. Mm-hmm. And when he gets there, everything is going to be all right. But you got to know he's on his way. You got to be confident. Yeah, you have people that are waiting for a ride for hours. And people be like, ain't you going to leave? No, they coming. And it's been 2 hours. No, I believe they coming. Mm-hmm. But we won't wait on God 20 minutes. And so if you have that kind of confidence in your ride, which you haven't risen, if you haven't gotten it by now, they left you. Amen. And you think they're coming back to get you. God ain't going to leave you, nor forsake you. So we have that to remember. So we step into this text tonight after having spent some time last week in the same text with the previous five verses. And tonight I just want you to talk. I want to talk about the fact that the life of a believer is a good life. Don't get me wrong, it's a good life, but it can also be very complicated. Mm-hmm. And the challenges that we face are not just because of the enemy, but because we are growing. We're growing in the Lord. We're increasing in our knowledge. And what Paul presents in this chapter, this letter to the Romans, is that the church is fractured. Because the church is still trying to figure out how to get to this relationship with God. And more importantly, how to apply the principles and precepts of God that's going to make my life better. And it's hard because the opposition is closer than anybody knows. It's not the person down on the other row. It's not the person in the job. It's really not the person in the house. The real issue is me. The real issue is the fact that I am still wrapped in flesh. And because I'm wrapped in flesh, the capacity to do wrong, more importantly, the capacity to oppose God, is a real issue, and I'm fighting with it every day. And that's what Paul exposes in this seventh chapter of Romans, and then this eighth chapter where he offers these words of encouragement. And so the complexity of our lives is driven by the realities of living in a world filled with sin. That's just reality. Amen. I've had some good days. I've had some hills to climb. It sounds real good. And boy, when they work that song, I love it just as much as you do. But the reality is, we live in a world filled with sin. Yeah. And we live in a world filled with wicked people. Yeah. And then we work with them, we live with them, we walk with them, we go to the grocery store with them, we bank with them everywhere. We buy cars from them, the whole nine yards. They serve in high places. But Paul talks about that, and so does the Lord talk about the fact that evil and wickedness will not go away as long as this world exists. Mm-hmm. So it's time for the church to grow up. We need to stop whining about what we don't have, what the enemy is trying to do, and Satan has done this and that for me. No, my Bible tells that my God is greater. And if my God is greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And if my God has already declared and proclaimed that I'm going to have victory in Jesus, then my work is in building and strengthening and maintaining my relationship with Jesus. Because that's where my strength comes from. And so if I really want to be victorious, I ought not to try to worry about what they're doing outside. I got to worry about what's happening in here, not in the building, in my heart. Because that's where the change takes place. That's where my transformation is going to take place. And Paul is simply trying to get to the heart of the church and let them know that the focus is not other people. The focus is Jesus Christ. The focus should be the works of the Holy Spirit. The focus should be the fact that God thought enough of us to send his son, that we would have access not only to him, but to eternal life. And when we understand the capacity of what God is able to do and the lack of capacity that we have to get it accomplished without him, then we're on our way to the right place. We are on our way somewhere. So what Paul is doing tonight is he's trying to break open the idea that the living a life in the spirit realm is where we need to spend most of our time. In chapter number 7, Paul talks about the struggles. In chapter number 8, he now brings full circle the fact that, yes, I have struggles. Those struggles are a result of who I am. And then he goes on in chapter 8, says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in prize of these seasons. But he goes on in that same verse to say this: for them that walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Now, one of the things that you have to remember about this eight chapter, this part of it, was not does not appear in the original letter to the church at Rome. Part of it does not appear in Hebrew or Greek. And so there's some insertions that are provided for us to deepen our knowledge and clarify what the verse is really trying to say. So in this first chapter, I mean, this eighth chapter, in this first verse, Paul says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. That's where the verse ends in the original text. But in order for us to really understand the complexity of the challenge, he goes on to say, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Which means now he says we have a choice of how we're going to live our lives. He raises a very valid point that we are in the midst of the world. You and I who are of Christ are planted in the midst of this world. But the world is not in us because we have Jesus. But we still have to make it in this world. So you have to study this word to understand and know how to make it in this world despite the fact that you're here, but the world is not in you. Mm-hmm. And God is not going to take you out of this world until he's ready for you. But as long as you're in the world, you've got to operate and function in God's will.
Amen. Amen.
And that doesn't come without a wrestle. It doesn't come without a fight. It doesn't come without a struggle. But you can overcome these things. And that's what Paul is trying to teach us. And what we do is, he reminds us of this. To live life in the Spirit would mean that the believer has chosen to walk in the deliverance and salvation of the Lord Jesus. That's important for us to understand. Mm-hmm. That our deliverance comes from God. Our deliverance in the New Testament comes through Jesus Christ. Because our salvation comes through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And so Jesus is very adamant and very clear about what his role is. And that's what we're learning. What is our role? And when we learn to live out our purpose, that's when we begin to really receive the revelation from God. And so in Isaiah 61, Jesus proclaims the gospel or liberty to the captives. And that's a part of his assignment, is to proclaim. And the word proclaim in the Old Testament is to call out. Liberty in the Old Testament means freedom, spontaneous of overflow, spontaneity of overflow. So when Jesus is proclaiming, when Isaiah is proclaiming the prophetic word about Jesus, he gives us a full definition of what Jesus will do. And then in the New Testament, Jesus picks up in the fourth chapter of Luke, and he too then begins to explain who it is or what it is that he's come to do. He, in that fourth chapter, says to preach deliverance to the captives and to set at liberty them that are bruised. And I found that to be very interesting, that he himself now knows what his role is and what his purpose is. And so our challenge becomes, what is our role and our purpose? We weren't just born just to be born. God had a purpose for our lives. We quote all day long Jeremiah 1. I know the thought, Jeremiah 29:11. I know the thoughts and plans that I have for you. They are thoughts of good and not of evil. Yeah, that sounds real good until you put it to work and realize that the plan that God has for your life is not just to write you in and get you there. No, he's going to set you in there, and then you got to work. Amen. Work to get to where God wants you to be. He's going to make the way for you, but you got to do something. It's something expected of every one of us. And so Jesus begins to talk about proclaiming and preaching. And deliverance in the New Testament is freedom. And the captives are those of us who are prisoners of war. And that prisoner of war was important for me to understand. Because Jesus came to free me from my prison. And the prison is the fact that the law, according to Paul, had the law of sin, rather, has kept me bound. And so because Jesus came to die on the cross and died for my sins and paid the price, here it is, for my sins, now I'm no longer bound by the law of sin. Mm-hmm. So, but I got to pick up something. So he presented the law of the Spirit. So I can't live according to the law of sin, but he opens a way for me to live according to the law of Spirit. And then Paul says, I got to make that choice every morning. It's not one and done. I wish you were. I wish you could make that one decision, lock us in until eternity rolls, but it don't work like that. I still got to work. And so Paul lets us know that the struggle is real. Paul also says that the pressure that we face in this life shouldn't cause us to stray away from the Lord or be overtaken with the fall. Said it's just not necessary. It's too much. So God has done too much for us to use excuses for why we can't make it. And the reason why we can't make it is because to live a life pleasing to God, to live a life in the spirit realm means that I gotta allow God to do what? Help me live beyond my capacity. I'm limited to what I can do. As a person, as a human being, I'm limited to what I can do. But God has no limits. Mm-hmm. And so I gotta be able to live according to God's will, because that's where my limitlessness comes from. As long as I live within my own, I'm going to always be limited. I'm going to always be confined to what I can do. You know what I'm saying? But when I walk in God's will for my life, then there's a capacity that I have that goes beyond my physical man and moves into the spirit realm, which is living by the Spirit or living in the Spirit. And that's what Paul is talking about. So Paul says to the church at Corinth in 1 Corinthians 10, 11 and 13. I want to read that for you real quickly. Because of what it says. It's a familiar passage, but I want you to hear it. Here's what Paul says. Now all these things happen unto them for examples, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the end of the world are come. And what that means is that what Paul is saying, that you all had to go through these things so that we can have a written example. Mm-hmm. So you and I, when we read the Word of God, we got something to reference. In other words, their failures, their mistakes, and even their successes have been written so that you and I will have a roadmap. The word here, these examples, are written for our admonition. Admonition in the Greek means instructions. Mm-hmm. So God allowed us to see other people's lives so that we can use their walk as our instructions. The word here for our world are come is ages. So we're living in the new age. We're living in the age where the revelations that were not presented at those times have now been released to the body of Christ. Mm-hmm. So there are some truths that they were not even aware of, yet they were still walking by faith. But those truths had not been born until now, where you and I have the privilege of knowing what it is that God meant and then using these examples to help us make better decisions. But if we got all this and we still making bad choices, then something wrong. Right. Then we missed the mark. We Amen. Don't realize the seriousness of building a strong relationship with God, and that there are no excuses. Why? Because if we're walking in the spirit and not in the flesh, then we're living life beyond our capacity. When I don't feel like it, that's beyond my capacity. And I go anyway, that's beyond my capacity. When I'm broken, but yet I still feel the urge to keep moving, that's beyond my capacity, because that's the spirit of the living God that's now awakened in me and Amen. Is moving in me. And I thank God for the Spirit, because without the Spirit, many of us wouldn't be here today. Because we would have given up a long time ago. We would have stopped at the first sickness, or given up at the first broken situation. The first time we failed, we wouldn't have gotten up. And without the Spirit being there to motivate us and encourage us, we would have given up. And many of us would have died in our sins. But Amen. Thanks be to God that the Holy Spirit has been moving on our behalf. Christ has been interceding on our behalf. So God is releasing, yet still blessings, as well as revelations, so that you and I can grow, so that we don't have to suffer or miss the move of God because our flesh is unwilling to move any further.
Amen.
Peter says it like this. Jesus said it like this to Peter. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. That's important for us to understand, because the natural things that we give into are what our capacity is. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. When I'm sleepy, I go to sleep. That's what my capacity is. But what Jesus was asking of them is, try to live and move beyond your body being tired, so that you can be aware of what's happening in the spirit realm. Because a lot of times we allow our physical man to take control, and we miss the move of God. We fall asleep, or we get tired, we get burdened, we get broken, we become discouraged, disgusted, and when those things begin to happen, we're now giving into the physical capacity that we have. But we got to walk in the spirit. That's what Paul says. Walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit. Mm-hmm. Which means that I have to live in the spirit. Does that make sense?
Amen.
To live in the spirit means I got to know the word. To live in the spirit means that I got to have a relationship with God. To live in the spirit means that I have to know Jesus and surrender to Jesus. That's what living in the spirit means. That the Holy Spirit now dwells in me as a result of my walk with Christ. That's how it works. And so if I don't have Christ, I don't have the spirit, I can't live in the spirit.
Amen.
Amen. You can't just live in Indian Hills. Amen. You got to be able to afford to live in that community.
Amen.
And so you can go talk about you going to buy a house. Amen. But when they check your credit, they're not going to let you on the driveway. Amen. Because they know you can't afford it. But when God is moving on your behalf. I don't care what they check at the credit rating. When God says it's for you, then you move in beyond your capacity. But the word declares that the blessings of the Lord are rich and added no sorrow. So God is not going to take you into Indian Hills or take you into these other communities without making provisions for you on every level. But that does not excuse the fact that you still got to work. Got to work. There's no excuse. So Paul pushes the envelope a little bit more, and he says that the church and every believer is to walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit. Walk not. The word not is critical. Walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit. The key word again is not. So this is not the way or the lifestyle or the things that you should be doing. And when you begin to break down the word flesh, it simply comes down to being defined as the human being. So that's really deep. Paul says, don't be yourself. If you're gonna make it in this life, you can't be yourself. Mm-hmm. And what he means by that is that your normal natural proclivity is to give in to the flesh. That's what the mind is. It's dominated by the things of this world. That's what that means. So when he gets to verse number 6, 7, and 8, he starts out verse 6 by saying, to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Mm-hmm. So let's break that down real quick. To be carnally minded, he identifies that there's a difference, or distinguishes the difference between levels of spiritual maturity. There are three levels of minds in the spirit, or in the things of God. There's the natural mind, there's the carnal mind, and there's the spiritual mind. And so many of us in the church, hopefully and prayerfully, are between carnal and spiritual. Mm-hmm. But yet there are people out of the world who have no connection or relationship with God whatsoever. They're in the natural mind, which means that they're living according to this. Mm-hmm. Whatever this comes up with, that's what I'm going to do.
Yeah.
Without any consciousness of God or remorse or any type of thought, whether or not this is the right thing or the wrong thing. That's natural minded, amen? But when I grow a little bit, just a little bit, I move into the next level, and the carnality or the carnal mindedness of my actions means that I'm vacillating back and forth. And what Paul is talking about is that Paul proposes to the church that we are incapable of living according to God's kingdom principles and precepts as long as we vacillate back and forth between the flesh and the spirit. The thing that I love about this text the most is Paul is not afraid to deal with the elephant in the room. A lot of times we are afraid to deal with the elephant in the room. That means that we come into a room and everybody in the room is falling by the wayside. Mm-hmm. But we're growing in the Lord, but we're afraid to say something.
Amen.
We want friends. We don't want them to put us out the room. We want them to invite us back to the meeting. We want to be invited to dinner. So we don't say nothing about what's going on.
Right.
But Paul says specifically to the church at Galatia, when you see a brother overtaken with a fall, you who are spiritual, there it is, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness. Don't let